So before we look at other examples, let's now have a look at the general derivation method of perturbation theory. What is probably most important here is to understand the general idea. As you recall, this relies on separating the known quantum system, the unperturbed system, for which we know all the solutions, out of the complete perturbed system, for which we want to find the solutions, at least approximately, and the remaining term defines the perturbation of strength lambda. And to obtain the approximate solutions, we similarly decompose them into terms representing different orders of lambda, so expand this as a series and powers of lambda. Depending where we truncate here, we will get approximations of different accuracy. This will of course also depend on whether this series here converges. So we start with these expressions for the new energy and the new eigenstate. They are just the same as the ones that I wrote down along with the main result before we looked at how this all works in practice in our first example. And the main result was just a simple explicit expression for the term E1 in the series for the energy. So now to actually determine the terms in these expansions, we insert them into the Schrödinger equation and multiply everything out. This includes the Hamiltonian on the right-hand side, so for this too we also use the separated form with the part describing the simpler system and the part describing the perturbation. I am giving here all terms up to second order, you could of course continue. By arranging the terms as given, we ordered all terms on both sides by powers of lambda. We require that both sides of this equation remain identical when we vary lambda, and from this it follows that all the different orders must match up on both sides. So this gives us an equation for each order in lambda. In the zeroth order, we simply recover the Schrödinger equation for the original quantum system. In the other orders, we get relations between the states and energies of the original and the perturbed system. I list these here again up to second order. To obtain explicit expressions from these, we can make use of the following features. That we not only know the solutions of the unperturbed system, but can also re-express this as an analogous equation for the dual state. This really uses that the Hamiltonian here is Hermitian and the energies are real. And that the solutions here can be normalized, and that when you look at two different ones, when needed, I will then use indices N and M to distinguish them. They are orthogonal. The latter fact also follows because the Hamiltonian is Hermitian. So let us have a look how we can use the relation in first order of lambda. I just copied it here, leaving some space so that we can now multiply this from the left by the original eigenstate psi naught. Now the term which I indicate here is just the Schrödinger equation rewritten for the dual state I just mentioned, so we can express it in terms of the energy, and in this way it cancels with the term that I underline. So there are only two terms left. In the first one you can pull out the constant E, and when you then use the normalization condition, you obtain an explicit expression for the coefficient appearing in the first order correction of the energy. It turns out to be just an expectation value of the perturbation, namely evaluated in the known unperturbed state, which just gives us our main result of perturbation theory. In some cases, we want to go beyond this main result. For instance, we could find that this correction vanishes, so that the main response to the perturbation occurs in a higher order of lambda. And by looking at such higher order corrections, we can also make sure that they are indeed small, perhaps even determine if the series in lambda converges, which would affirm that the studied phenomenon is indeed perturbative. Finally, in some cases, we are also interested to see how much the eigenstate has changed. Well, to obtain information about the quantum state, we can use the same relations as before, but multiplied by another eigenstate of the original system. Now we need some extra indices to distinguish these states. I take n for the perturbed state we are interested in, and m for the original state that we compare it with. So that's the state of the simpler system. As before, we can identify here a term that is just containing the Schrödinger equation for the dual state, but this term now not just cancels because it involves a generally different energy. Instead, we can use the orthogonality of the states to cancel the indicated term. We can rearrange this as shown. And to keep things manageable, we introduce a shorthand notation for the terms involving the perturbation. These terms are known as the matrix elements of the perturbation. Indeed, they are the matrix elements of this operator written in the basis of the original energy eigenstates. Now, what we obtained in this way is a relation for the scalar product between the original state and the leading correction in the new state. And these terms are really just the expansion coefficients of this correction in the basis of the original eigenstates. We therefore find the following correction for the perturbed eigenstate. Note that the sum here runs over all indices except the index of the state that we're interested in. But this state is of course already included in the zeroth order. What we have written down here is just what we have to add to this to find a better approximation for this perturbed state. According to the denominator, we see that the main contributions tend to come from states that are close in energy. I will come back to this point very soon. Now, this expression is also useful when we want to evaluate the second order correction to the energy. Beyond some practical calculations where we may want to use this to get a better approximation, this also helps us to understand when perturbation theory can be expected to work well. So, following our general approach, we now take the relation in second order and multiply this by the quantum state of the simpler system. I now keep the index n, as the other states will soon reappear. We can again invoke the Schrödinger equation for the dual state to cancel two terms. Now, looking at the underlined term, recall that we just mentioned that the first order correction to the state does not contain the unperturbed state. So its expansion coefficient vanishes. But this is just what we have in this term, given that En1 is just a constant that we can pull out to the front. So now only two terms are left again. In the second one, we can insert the full form of the leading correction to the state. We then again encounter the matrix elements of the perturbation. This is a Hermitian matrix, as it is the difference of two Hermitian operators, the Hamiltonians of the original and the perturbed quantum system. So we can rewrite this so that together with the other term, this becomes its absolute value squared. And finally, using again the normalization condition in the first term, we see that we now have an explicit expression for the second order correction of the energy. Let us collect our results and write down the approximation of the energy up to second order in lambda. Now that we have introduced the perturbation matrix, we can use this also in the first order term. There you see that it enters with a diagonal element. That's a relatively compact expression, which is quite useful for calculations. As I mentioned, you often only use the first order correction here, which only involves a single state, and whose interpretation as an expectation value is physically transparent. But there are quite a few places where you would also use the second order term, especially if the first order vanishes, and I will illustrate this result for calculation in the next example. But first, let me point out that besides its utility in practical calculations, the second order term is also useful because it allows us to draw some very general conclusions. The most important feature of this expression is the denominator here, which involves differences of energies in the original quantum system. This again tells us that the main contributions arise from states that are close in energy and helps us to determine if our perturbation indeed has a small effect on the system, hence whether our approach is really valid. In particular, if two energies become close, then looking at the sign with which this difference enters the term in second order, one finds that the perturbation drives them apart. This is known as level repulsion and gives a very characteristic dependence of energy levels when you change a typical parameter of a system. This expression also tells you that levels can cross. These instances are really called level crossings, when their matrix element vanishes, which typically is an indication of symmetries in the system. The crossing states then behave differently under the symmetry. Say, if this is a spatial reflection and the perturbation preserves the symmetry, this would happen if one state is even and the other one is odd under the reflection. So we can learn about such features even without actually calculating any of the involved expressions. We do not even need to know the unperturbed states for this. To draw another general conclusion from these expressions, we compare the size of the different terms. This requires a bit more insight into the actual values of the expressions, but only in a roundabout way. We only care about the typical size of our perturbation, which I denote as W, and the typical energy spacing in our original system, which I write as delta E. This isn't an uncertainty, just a scale for the quantization, and we are thinking here of adjacent energy levels. Then we find that the different terms have a typical size as given here. Now our approximation has a good chance to be accurate if this condition given here holds true. The second order correction is then generally much smaller than the first order correction. And if you rearrange this, then you find that this perturbation itself should be smaller than this typical energy spacing. But the perturbation just gives you the typical size of the leading correction to the energy levels. So, as a general rule, this version of perturbation theory gives good approximations when the corrections to the energies are smaller than their typical original spacing. Thirdly, we see that we seem to have a problem when energies are degenerate, so coincide for two different states of the original quantum system. This is again often the consequence of a symmetry, such as rotational symmetry in a three-dimensional system, where we can now have different states that are related by a rotation. And that's actually a very important case, because you would often find out about these degeneracies when you break them by a perturbation. The matrix elements then become finite. To figure out what happens then, we have to adjust our approach and apply what is known as degenerate perturbation theory. There we simply first truncate the system to the degenerate states, hoping that there aren't too many. That just involves the matrix of the perturbation truncated to these states. And then we find the eigenvalues and eigenstates of this truncated matrix. Often that's already all that you want to know, because it gives you the energies and states including the main effect of the perturbation. And if you want to carry on to even more accurate approximations, you can take these as a new starting point and then proceed perturbatively along the lines described above.